Whoa, what the heck is going on?
Jesus.
Oh no, it's happening again. Lord, have mercy.
Holy crap.
You know, I was working on an orchestral mock-up using Logic and Vienna Summer Pro when it suddenly stopped. All the graphic here in all the three monitors went really weird, with some, scattered polygons all over the place. I went then for a forced turning off the computer, then I turned it on again. Well, at least that's what I tried. Meaning that I'm now stuck at this point with a loading bar never ending its loading process. Great, brilliant. In the last 4 years, all that freaking stuff has happened, at least I think three, four times. I usually had to reinstall again all the operating system OS X from scratch again. But this time, the brutal thing, I think, is that I'm simply not able to access the recovery startup mode to hard format the operating system, and much more relevant, to save all the work I was doing, yes? Which, by the way, I think it's definitely lost.
Lost in time and lost in space.
Now, I guess, my dear Mekith, this is the end.
Don't let me do what I know I'm just going to do, no matter what. You friggin' bloody Cupertino, California. In each other's hearts.
So, hear the beast. Or at least what is supposed to be the beast, you know? Let's do a brief overview of it. Let's check all the different ports here in the front and there in the back. And let's compare the previous Mac Pro 2010 with that new Mac Studio, right? So let's start with the USB port, because my old Mac Pro had a lot of them, you know? Two USB ports in the front, and seven in the back. So 9 USB ports in total. Mac Studio 2. Mac Pro could host 2 HDMI ports and 1 display port or a VGA port. Mac Studio has just 1 HDMI and no display port and no VGA at all. Mac Pro had 2 Ethernet ports. Mac Studio has just 1. Mac Pro 2010 had other different type, let's say, of ports, which have now become obsolete, so Mac Studio doesn't have them anymore. And of course, Mac Studio has other kinds of ports, which simply didn't exist when Mac Pro were built in 2010, like these 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, Thunderbolt, 4 ports, 4 of them in the back and 2 in the front. Lastly, Mac Studio has a SDXC memory card slot here in the front and an output for your headphones here in the back. Obviously, Mac Studio, it has no CD player, you know, like the Mac Pro had. But you know, who cares nowadays about CDs, right? So, as a recap, Mac Studio seems to have less ports compared to the old Mac Pro, but obviously they are drastically more powerful and faster. Now, I wanna let you see all the devices as they were connected to the old Mac Pro, and let's see how should we connect them now to the new Mac Studio. You'll find all the links, all the adapters and all the stuff I've bought for that purpose in this description here down below. Screens. Let's begin with the screens. I have three of them. LG and HP were previously connected to the Mac Pro through a HDMI port, whereas AOC used a display port. Now in the Mac Studio I'll use this integrated HDMI port for the HP monitor, and both for LG and AOC I connect them to two Thunderbolt ports, and both for LG and AOC I'll connect them, I think, to these two Thunderbolt ports through an USB-C HDMI or USB-C DisplayPort adapter. Audio interface. It was previously connected through USB to the old Mac Pro, and I think I'm going to keep the USB connection even here on the Mac Studio. You know, the audio interface is probably one of the most relevant pieces of device when you work with digital music. So, I mean, you better have a dedicated port for it, you know, just in case. Internal SSDs. Because, you know, the old Mac Pro had four SSDs. These four inside of it. Now, in order to keep a solid and powerful performance, I'm going to connect three of them to this ColdDigit Element Hub. Because, you know, this ColdDigit Element Hub can host no more than exactly three Thunderbolt ports, which are obviously at the moment the fastest connections. And the last SSD, I wanna connect it directly to a Thunderbolt port here in the backside of Mac Studio. So, just to recap, how many Thunderbolt ports I'm going to use so far? Two for the screens. I have three screens, one HDMIs and two screens with Thunderbolt ports. So two for the screens, one for the hub and one for the last SSD. That way I'll exploit all the four ports here, the Thunderbolt ports here in the backside, and I'll have the last two Thunderbolt ports, these guys here in front, at my disposal. Computer keyboard use Bluetooth. Ethernet port, and last but not least, power cable. And here we are, finger crossed. I'll see you in the next days. Bye. So here we are. Everything seems to be set exactly how I've planned it should have been so far. So now follow me in the back just for a while. And so here we have in these four Thunderbolt ports, external SSD, ColdDigit Thunderbolt port USB, second monitor, third monitor, Ethernet port, power supply, Elgato capture card. Oh, by the way, if you have any capture card, make sure you connect it directly to your machine, not using USB or other cable, otherwise it won't work properly. USB hub, HDMI for the first monitor. Then we have over there the ColdDigit Thunderbolt hub. These are three external SSDs. And now come back to the front side. And this is the front side of ColdDigit Thunderbolt hub, Cork Studio MIDI controller, Expressive Touche MIDI controller, Vienna Ensemble Pro USB dongle, audio interface. Now let's move to
to the USB hub. External hard drive 1, external hard drive 2, external hard drive 3, external hard drive 4, external hard drive 5, Neova MIDI ring controller,
which is this one. And you can find over there the link of a video I made some month ago on this Neova MIDI ring.
And last but not least, mouse,
which by the way is the most important thing I have here in my setting here.
And as I have planned here, I've gotten these two last Thunderbolt ports at my disposal here in the front of Mac Studio.
So for the time being, we can assume the hardware part of this story and of this video is definitely complete, right? Everything seems to be working properly, at least everything which I've been able to test so far, I mean basic connections and devices. Now let's dive in the software chapter. So after 1 week, I think I've completed now the installation of all basic softwares as I had before. Everything has gone pretty much smoothly and easy. I basically updated my softwares to the Apple Silicon M1 version of Mac. Very few of them I had to bought it for the right ARM architecture, but actually after all I've been able to reinstall all softwares I had before with no problems. All except two of them. I'm going now to discuss briefly these software which encountered some problem, some issue, because you know for my money these softwares are just essential to my work and simply unavoidable for my workflow. For the first one I have found a solution, not so for the second one, at least until now. So first issue I had when installing software was with the G-Hub by Logitech. The software this G600 gaming mouse by Logitech comes with, which is essential to let this mouse do basically everything it's supposed to do, like assigning to each one of its 20 buttons, action and shortcuts, right? Now I always got this message, unblock driver. And I tried to find everywhere on the web to solve this issue, but alas, probably that's my fault, but probably it's even Logitech team fault, I think. It was really, really frustrating because I couldn't access that edit page where I could assign to each button of the 20 buttons the right function, basically. Anyway, I found a solution, which you can find at this link here above if you're interested, getting definitely rid of G-Hub and using Steer Mouse instead. Now this amazing software SwitchOS X lets you customize, let's say, the resolution of your displays, of your screens. You can set for each one of your screens, if you're using more than just one, a different kind of resolution, choosing among the most frequent ones, or even have your own custom resolution exactly as you want to. Now I had no problem at all using it with my old 2010 Mac Pro. I was really happy, for instance, to be able to force a custom higher resolution for two of my screens. For the HP, this one you can see here, which has a standard resolution 1920 by 1080. So I was able to set a higher resolution than this one. And same thing for this one, LG screen, which by the way, it's not a computer display, but an old, very old TV. Well, cut long story short, this fairy tale is no more possible with Apple Silicon Macs. SwitchOS X simply does not work at its full potential with M1 chip, at least until now. You can switch from one standard resolution to another standard resolution, but you're stuck with standard resolutions, right? You're not going to have an happy marriage with custom resolutions. Custom resolutions are not working anymore on M1 Max with SwitchOS X. I still have to find the right software which can solve this problem, but I guess it doesn't exist yet. So, end of the story, I'm working now with just with the factory resolution of my display. HP is still good, but
you know, algae is bum.
So after 1 month, I've completed now, I think, the installation of all my previous music softwares and plugins. I had my old Mac Pro, and good news is that I've been able to update all of them to M1 version. So I want to reassure you, anyone out there who is scared about switching from Intel to Silicon, like I was, me myself, now that we are in 2023, the time I'm speaking to you now, pretty much every music software or plugin developer has been able to convert to M1 ERM chip. I'll put the link in the description here down below where you can find a list of all the main music plugin developers from all over the world specifying whether or not they have already updated their products to Apple Silicon, or they're planning in the next future to do so, or may have an estimated time of arrival or whatever. By the way, I suggest you to visit the single developer's website to be extremely sure about that. Now, just to close my journey as a musician, switching from Mac Pro 2010 to Mac Studio 2022, I want to give you a list of all music softwares and plugins I'm using now at the moment in Logic. Actually, the same I was using with Intel Mac Pro and now updated to Silicon M1 Mac Studio. So everyone is wondering how tricky is switching from one system to the other. Could take my story, you know, like a reference for his own or her own. So let's go.
Contact. Omnisphere. Dune 3. Avenger, Nexus 3, UJAM, Addictive Drums, AK Multimedia, Yuhi, TuneTrack, Reactor, Arturia, Roland Cloud, Waves, Eventide, FabFilter, Isotope, Native Instruments, Magma, Sonal Access, Valhalla, Waves Factory, X-Ray Records, Kilohertz.
Wow, I'm now bloody curious to hear what kind of monstrous sound I've made here. That's great. Lastly, another important, real important plugin I'm using in my workflow is Vienna Ensemble Pro, in order, you know, to manage a really rich amount of sample libraries and virtual instruments within the same session. It was really, really helpful, I would say inevitable, working with my old Mac Pro, because, you know, that old Intel CPU simply couldn't keep up with tones of operation being involved at the same time and dozen of MIDI tracks. Now, one could argue, why the hell are you still keeping it in Mac Studio? Is Mac Studio powerful enough to manage all these processes with no need of external softwares like exactly Vienna Ensemble Pro? Well, I guess yes, you're right, my lovely mates. Mac Studio could do that with no problem, and you would have a smooth workflow even when using many, many MIDI tracks and sample libraries, I suppose. Quite sure, maybe. Listen, I would lie to you if I'll tell you yes, you'll have absolutely no problems at all using hundreds and hundreds and thousands of virtual instruments and sample libraries asking you for a crappy amount of RAM and CPU. Your amazing Mac Studio would always save you from this hell, no doubt. Maybe this is true, or maybe not, or simply I don't know. And to be honest,
to you, I don't want to know. That's why I keep on using Vienna Ensemble Pro, which, by the way, is definitely amazing. And if you are interested in that topic, you could watch this playlist I've made some month ago on VPro, Vienna Ensemble Pro, to understand its stunning potential when working with a lot, a really huge amount of sample libraries in the same project. Yet, this being said, I've got a sad news for everyone who's working on a Silicon Mac with Vienna Ensemble Pro and Logic. Because unfortunately Logic, at least from its actual version, 10.7.6, 10.7.4, I believe it hasn't such an issue. It won't recognize AU3 Vienna Ensemble Pro plugin. It just won't start when loading up. This kinda sucks, isn't it? Because if you don't know, AU3 plugin would let Logic access to all MIDI ports beyond the first number one, letting you, for instance, have a really, really huge orchestral template, like with a lot of virtual instruments per one single instance on VPro. Anyway, I don't want to bother you anymore on that aspect, but I suppose everyone who knows very well VPro knows the shit I'm talking about. So I've bought this Mac Studio basically to enhance all my working with computer music, to boost the performance of my DAW, to have a smooth workflow with thousands of sample libraries and virtual instruments being involved at the same time, the same project. So now question is, has it been the right choice? Has Mac Studio delivered what it promised, at least till now? Could we call it kind of one of the most powerful machine to work with music or something along those lines, right? Well, to be honest, I can't answer now to this question. I probably need a bit of extra time to evaluate if my workflow has really improved and how much has it improved. Obviously, anyone could say Mac Studio is enormously more powerful than my previous Mac Pro, which was built in 2010. No way, that's a matter of fact. M1 chip is another world compared to Intel processor. All connections like Thunderbolt port 4, of course, are incredibly faster than USB, for instance. What really strikes me about that machine, at least that's my perception, is how amazingly fast it is when working at especially when working at basic, common, standard operations inside its operative system. Like, I don't know, moving tons of gigabytes from one folder to another, boom, done. Or when empty the bin from thousands of gigabytes of files, boom, done. Or installing new softwares. I mean, in these basic operations, you can easily realize how fucking fast it is compared to any previous Intel Mac. But apart from that, if you want to get the best out of it, at least that's my suggestion, you'd be careful and you better use one its most powerful connections, like Thunderbolt ports, when connecting to some external devices, to M1 native softwares, not Intel ones. For instance, if you want to Logic open an old Intel plugin, you would tick open with Rosetta. But at this point, you would get a slower CPU performance, and the amazing speed of Mac Studio would sometimes drastically decrease compared to the M1 scenario.
Thank you.
So remember, Mac Studio, Thunderbolt ports, M1 Silicon softwares. When these three elements are combined together, you would experiment really flashlight speed. Thanks ever so much for putting up with me. I would really love to hear your thoughts, your stories, if you have switched to M1 Mac like me, for instance, your impressions, whatever. One of those is always welcome for efforts made here today, or actually in the last month by myself. Leave a comment in the comment section. If you're a new viewer to the channel, or a returning viewer, or never subscribed, hit subscribe now and hit that bell to be notified. Thanks so much for watching. Take care. Ich bin auf der Aramis, und wenn wir fahren.